This experiment asks you to design an aqueous exchange reaction using the principles from the previous experiment. Your instructor should have assigned you a target compound and mass. Start by determining the two chemicals you'll use to make your target compound. For copper 2 hydroxide, we'll need a source of both copper 2 and hydroxide. From the list of chemicals, there are two possible sources of copper 2, copper phosphate or copper sulfate. According to the solubility table, copper phosphate is insoluble. Copper sulfate should work. Magnesium hydroxide is also not soluble, so we'll use sodium hydroxide. Now that the compounds have been selected, a molecular reaction equation can be written. A coefficient of 2 must be added to sodium hydroxide to balance the equation. What this equation tells us is that for every 1 mole of copper hydroxide product, we'll need 1 mole of copper sulfate and 2 moles of sodium hydroxide. Since our target amount is given in units of mass, we'll need to first convert into moles. By dividing 0.5 grams of copper hydroxide by the molar mass, we get 0.005125 moles of copper hydroxide. According to the stoichiometry of the equation, this means we need the same number of moles of copper 2 ions and twice that number of moles of hydroxide ions. Our copper 2 sulfate is provided as a pentahydrate, so we must make sure to incorporate the mass of those waters in the molar mass. 0.005125 moles of copper 2 sulfate pentahydrate is converted into grams by multiplying by the molar mass. This gives us a mass of 1.280 grams of copper sulfate pentahydrate. A similar calculation is done for sodium hydroxide, except the number of moles are doubled due to that stoichiometry. Since this is a solution of sodium hydroxide, we'll use the concentration instead of the molar mass to find a volume instead of a mass. We'll also include a unit conversion to get an answer in milliliters, and that gives us a volume of 5.125 milliliters of that 2 molar sodium hydroxide solution. Combining these two amounts of each ion source should get us the correct mass of our target compound. You should be able to complete this calculation ahead of time for your assigned compound and mass, so that you can begin working as soon as you arrive to class. Once you've precipitated your target solid, it must be separated from the liquid. The best way to do this is vacuum filtration. This is a vacuum filtration setup. First, the filtration flask is clamped down to a ring stand. Then, a vacuum hose is hooked up to the filtration flask and to the vacuum line. You'll want to place the tube out of the way. Next, a rubber ring is placed on top, and a Buchner funnel is placed in the ring. This creates an airtight seal. Lastly, a piece of filter paper is placed in the top of the Buchner funnel, and the vacuum is turned on. Now air is pulling through the whole system, so anything poured through here will separate solids from liquids. Any leftover solid can be rinsed with a spray bottle. To obtain a dry solid, the vacuum should be left on for about 10 minutes. When finished, the vacuum is simply turned off and the funnel can be removed. The solid can now be scraped into a container for weighing.